seminar, and it will be on environmental and water security, the common concerns of India and China. So first, Tarasi Jayaram will be speaking on reflections on environmental issues, Sino-Indian concerns.
So this is like an off-beat topic. Environment is a factor in India-China relations. Okay, it's definitely not a topic that started way back in 1962, or it's a topic which probably came up in the 21st century, right from 2000. Maybe that's when environment became an issue in international relations per se. So yeah. So I will start with the security challenges for India and China, theory and practice. I've listed a few issues here which are a common concern to both India and China: climate change, water security, land security, human security, energy security, and food security. One thing that you have to note here is that all these issues are very much interlinked, and you cannot segregate them and say that water security is not going to impact food security, or energy security is not going to impact human security. Coming to this topic, human security, now this is a very controversial concept because this is something which in countries like India and China do not really recognize. Because human security is an individual-centric security subject, which was actually introduced by the Western countries like the US, the UK, and much of Europe, of course. Because they said post-Cold War, in the post-Cold War era, suddenly, security became like a much bigger issue. You wanted to include everything under the ambit of security. They wanted to include development, they wanted to include water, food, everything. So then, the concept of human security came up, but then countries like India and China said, how can you even think about securitizing something basic as human life? So individual-centric security was not really something which went down well with both India and China. But then, in the past few years, there has been some movement in terms of securitizing human life or securitizing environment or any of these topics that you see here. Now, there comes the problem of what to call environmental security, whether it's non-traditional security threat or is it traditional security threat. Now, traditionally, you can say that something can become a security threat only if military is involved, which according to me is completely incorrect, because unless and until the well-being of the people in any country, because at the end of the day, international relations is highly state-centric. But environment per se is not state-centric. It permeates national boundaries. So you cannot help but talk about such issues without taking just the state into consideration, because that will be again counterproductive. So then, and security per se, this concept itself is highly exploited. You just want to securitize everything under the sky and just expect that can resolve the problem. That does not really happen. So that's the theory part of it. And I forgot about the traditional and the non-traditional part. So what I feel is that, something like all these issues, they have been there for ages. So how can you even call it non-traditional? The traditional security threats are these, while I feel non-traditional ones are like nuclear and wars, because these came up much later. So these are the non-traditional threats, I feel. So that's like my opinion. It's just up to you guys to figure out what is traditional and what is non-traditional. So that is something which I find the theory of international relations highly problematic in that sense. Something has to be done with that, especially in the security discourse. So that's what I wanted to look at, and I just probably reflect on a few issues in India and China. Water security, Madhuri will talk about that. Climate change is a big issue. Again, it's a highly politicized issue, so you have to be very careful while talking about how much it is going to impact our security in that sense. Land security, I'll just take one example. Tevika is doing a paper on that, in fact, Shanghai and Mumbai, if you look at these cities, Shanghai or Mumbai, these are in delta regions, and they are highly, highly vulnerable to storm surges and subsidence. If you look at Mumbai, it's like, you have like huge infrastructure which is completely unplanned. So, and you have Shanghai, another city where water is like extracted to such a level that cracks are like opening up on the roads. And now water is being pumped back into the earth so that, you know, the subsidence does not happen and Shanghai does not vanish one day. So, you know, this is land security, one of the issues you could probably think of, from the top of the head. Energy security, again, you know, some people just make the mistake of saying energy security means, you have to reduce carbon emissions, so you have to, change your energy portfolio, you have to bring in nuclear energy, which I feel is not an environmental issue, it's completely an energy issue. There is no point connecting nuclear energy to environmental discourse at all. Apart from that, investing a lot in renewable energy and stuff like that. But I feel, it's equally important to now look at risk assessment, which is how environmental change is going to affect energy infrastructure, which a lot of countries like India and China are not into at this point of time. Not just India and China, in fact, no country is doing risk assessment per se, because they're just taking for granted that environment is something which is, somehow it will stabilize at one point. But yeah, things are going out of control everywhere. Food security, there's something called virtual water, in fact, and food security is very much associated with that. India is not much into that, but China, if you look at China, China is involved in a lot of agricultural activities in Africa. They are cultivating food there and then taking that food from Africa to China, because China is deficient in water resources right now. It has enough resources in the Tibetan plateau, but it's not able to really use it to the extent that it can use. Things like these are really what affect international relations. Another thing which I have looked at in my work over the past 1 or 2 years is that I feel the three GOs is something which you have to look at, you have to look at very, very closely. Like, as a three geo, geophysical changes, geopolitical changes, and geoeconomic changes combine and interact, they reshape our landscape both literally and figuratively. Now, Arctic is a very good example where the opening of the sea route over Russia, which is geophysical changes, combined with China's new political and economic clout, which is geopolitical and geoeconomic changes, have resulted in an entirely new security situation, China as a pro-Arctic power. So, you have a country like China which is out of the Arctic region, but still it's been able to make its presence felt in the Arctic just because of its economic clout and just because of its political clout. So, as geophysical changes in the Arctic is actually helping China to go ahead and do that. Just show this map, how The distance between Rotterdam and Yokohama, the distance between China and Europe will be reduced to great extent if the Arctic opens up completely. Now, for example, this year, if you, you must have read in the news that, the ice sea melt was like the maximum. The extent was like the minimum this year. So, yeah. Now, I'm just taking two examples now, how for both China and India, strategic depth right now actually lies in the oceans. So this is South China Sea, which is very, very important for China. But all these islands over there, if you see, the Spratly Islands and the Paracel Islands, which are like currently still disputed between all these countries in Southeast Asia and China, all these islands are actually under the threat of submergence. Though they are very small islands, but they are highly strategic importance to all these countries because they have huge reserves of oil and gas. Plus, they could also be, some of the islands are slightly bigger in size, so they can be potential military bases as well. Nobody knows. So, because of that, these islands, if they submerge in the future, then basically the dispute actually ends itself. You don't have to do anything about it. You don't need to negotiate. You don't need to talk about it at all. It just gets over on its own. Like, for example, there was a dispute between India and Bangladesh over New Mor Island. It was along the Sundarbans. Like, and one particular day, the island disappeared and the dispute was over. So, you know, similar thing could happen over here in the South China Sea. But the problem is that environmental law, which, I mean, the islands are basically, I mean, islands and the oceans are controlled by the law, the UN clause, the United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea. And that law is very, very, like, I mean, it does not talk about environmental change, it does not take environmental change into consideration. So it does not say what happens, like, if, for example, tomorrow an island submerges or becomes, like, uninhabitable, what do you do? It does not say anything about such things. So the law is it has so many loopholes that countries can actually go to war even over, like, you know, submerged islands. That is a problem. In India's case, in fact, it's, India's ocean strategic depth is much more. You have, like, you know, because of these Lakshadweep islands and Andaman, we have, like, so much of depth. And apart from that, Maldives, here you have Maldives and this is Lakshadweep, which are geophysically very, very similar to each other. And, Maldives, for example, is very, I mean, it's just a few feet above sea level. Anything could happen anytime, and you have to be, like, I mean, Indian establishment has to be prepared for any kind of situation. And of course, here there may not be any kind of dispute, but just here you have Diego Garcia, and US would like to declare all of these as international waters, which is not good for India. Coming to the climate change discourse, which is of course something which appeals to everyone. Post-Kyoto Protocol is the inflection point, according to me. This marked the change in India and China's policies towards environment, a turn from being largely dormant to heavily emphasizing on climate change policies such as adaptation and mitigation. And this period was actually marked by economic downswing in the West and rapid ascendance in China and India's economic growth rates. Okay, so I'll just, like, briefly say what subjects, you know, China and India basically converge. I mean, this is something which has been done quite, like, vividly by a lot of experts. So just, like, I'll just briefly tell you, like, first is climate justice. Of course, India and China, right from the beginning, always said that they have the right to exploit resources as much as the Western countries did before, and they polluted the environment and they were the reason for climate change. So that is the first thing. Per capita principle is something which is quite dubious again. They talk about how, but they say this is the most legitimate principle based on which countries could negotiate. Per capita means both India and China have a huge population. Because of that, the per capita emissions are much lesser compared to Western countries. Though overall emissions, both India and China are, like, in the top three. China is the largest carbon emitter, and India is the third largest emitter right now. So US is the second largest. So, but the thing is, you know, when India goes to the negotiations table, it says there are 600 million Indians without electricity. So what you exactly are talking about is that these 600 million Indians are not exactly contributing to emissions. So what is this per capita principle? I really don't understand, you know, because it's kind of, again, you have to take into consideration all these things while negotiating. Common but differentiated responsibility, the word itself says that developed countries have to take the responsibility of mitigating climate change before developing countries, because the technologies lie with them, the financial resources lie within them. So they have to take responsibility for it. Again, on financial and technology transfer, China and India have always had a common stand that Western countries have to take the lead. Bottom-up approach means that both the countries have believed that the actions should be done within their countries, which can be reported to the UN. And there should not be any kind of infringement of the sovereignty of the country. So it's not like a top-down approach in which UN comes to India and does it for us, or UN monitors it, which is what measurement, reporting and verification means. Like, if there is anything domestically done, it should not be, like, a foreign body should not interfere. That is what both India and China have believed in. But intellectual property rights, this is something controversial. Till last year's summit Cancun, India and China had a common stand again that green technology should become, like, you know, drugs. like, you know, it's like pharmaceutical drugs. So basically, it should become like free for all. You shouldn't have intellectual property rights for that. How can you have that? This is like for the common, for the good of the whole humankind. You cannot make it like, you know, expensive for the developing countries. But China in the last summit, they said this is like not going to work, because China is now a leading exporter of green technology. So they have changed their stand and they said, we are going to sell our technologies and make money. India can, like, you know, do whatever it wants. So it has basically abandoned India. Apart from that, by 2020, of course, a new treaty is expected to come in place. Now, if that happens, both India and China will be forced to sign the treaty. But again, you know, the negotiations are done in such a way that nothing really happens. Even though, you know, countries sign on to it, they come out of it whenever they want. They don't, they don't really abide by the targets. So nothing really happens. But yeah, so China again is in a position in which its emissions are increasing at a rate. By 2015, its emission per capita emissions might itself exceed Europe's emissions. So in that case, China will be a lot under pressure compared to India. India is still like only 1 ton per annum. That's all. Its per capita emissions is much lesser even compared to China. So that way, convergence over climate change issues, I don't think it's going to be there in like another 2-3 years. China will be like not with us for sure. Some people say that China is a role model when it comes to environmental security. So lessons to be learned, probably one thing is China's heavy investment in renewable energy technology. It was like $54.4 billion in 2011. So that's like a huge amount. China was the highest investor along with US and Germany. So India is, in fact, in 2011, India invested lesser than South Africa and Brazil, for example. That's really a sad situation. Creation of Sustainable Development Fund is something else which China has done. I don't know if you have heard about the clean development mechanism by which technologies are transferred to developing countries through the UN. And actually people call it the China Development Mechanism, because China gets almost 90% of the projects and money from it, and no other country gets anything out of it. So, you know, and it's also called the Corruption Development Mechanism, because it's like rocked with corruption, and especially because all the money goes into China, it's like more susceptible to being used in wrong projects. That renewable technology cooperation is something which a lot of people have talked about, you know, between India and China, but that has not really taken off, especially because China has just started to export its technology. So of course it would like to monopolize on that and then, you know, probably use India as a partner, which again I don't think is going to happen very soon. China's negotiating style is like, of course, everywhere they say one thing and they do something else, which is not the case with India. India actually goes, says whatever it wants, and it's actually, you know, like branded as somebody who doesn't want to listen to anything and wants to defy everything. So India has got a much bad image compared to China in the negotiations for all the good reasons. Lessons to be avoided are like Three Gorges Dam, North-South Canal. These are like actions which are like directed at controlling environment rather than managing environment. And China has in fact always talked about how to control environment. And they have actually believed in controlling everything, not just environment, human beings, everything under the sky. They would like to control. So that's like one quote I have taken. This is way back. One of the hydraulic engineers said this. I don't feel we are conquering nature. We think nature itself isn't fair. God isn't fair. What is that? He has given southern China so much water, but given the north so little. It's good land, nice flat land up there, but it's got so little water. So we say, as God isn't fair, we are trying to balance out God's unfairness. So, you know, these are some of the moments in which China talks about God. Apart from that, centralization of environmental governance system at the domestic level. It's very much centralized. Everything is centralized, because of which you know, a lot of practices are kind of environment non-friendly. Just would like to touch briefly on future strategy. Both countries are trying to build self-sufficiency, of course. Secondly, joint R&D is something which both countries might talk about in the future, but for that India has to make some like heads up, like, you know, they need to like at least make some progress in this field, because right now we are only buying technology from the West. We have not done much of